With Michele Vargas. So let me introduce Michele. She is an aromatherapist who is an active member in several aromatherapy associations. She teaches internationally on essential oil uses and safety, as well as how to eliminate toxic products from one's life. She openly shares her personal struggle with chronic migraine and has become well known in the headache community. She is a patient advisory board member of Miles for Migraine and patient leadership council of the National Headache Foundation, and was a former board member of American Headache and Migraine Association. For several years, she has participated in speaking to her legislators during the Headache on the Hill event in Washington, D.C. Welcome, Michele.
Hi, it's great to be here. Thank you for that introduction. Hopefully everyone has enjoyed all the talks today and all the questions, and you will enjoy our last session here, and we're almost done, so hang in there with us. Again, my name is Michele Vargas, and just to reiterate, I do have chronic migraine, and being an aromatherapist has been quite beneficial, as well as being married to a headache specialist. So many of you have probably heard of him. It's Dr. Bert Vargas. He's a headache specialist, as well as a neurosports specialist. And we have three children, one adult son, as well as two twin 9-month-old boys. So our life has dramatically changed, and it's been lots and lots of fun. So even, I'm gonna put my screen on so I can see here. We even have two male cats, so I am surrounded by males. I'm the only female, which is sometimes lots of fun. So I do use essential oils on everyone, including our infants and our pets. So that's another topic for another day, but I just wanted to let everyone know that is something also that I do. And I did start using essential oils back in 1989 and really dove into the science of it and the research that was available, which has been prolific since the 2000s on essential oils, once we were trying to get pregnant and trying to hopefully have that help everything that we were doing and trying to have children. I'm going to share my screen and let you see. Let's see here. All right. Here we go. Okay, and my disclosures as well. Sorry, get my little thing out of the way. I am not a physician, I do want to let you know, and I can't answer disease-specific questions. I do want to try to address what I can, absent from any branding and just being very specific to singular essential oils. This information is not intended to replace your current medication, your medical plan of care, or the advice of your licensed healthcare practitioner. And the statements that I'm making have not been evaluated by the Food and Drug Administration. And the products I'm talking about, which is essential oils, is not intended to diagnose, treat, cure, or prevent disease. This is complementary to what you have going on with your physician. She has already mentioned the board organizations that I am involved with, as well as the aromatherapy associations, and I do receive compensation from Young Living as well. Let's see her, sorry. Headache types and oils for support. Now this is headache types and facial pain. We're gonna talk about several of these things, but primarily focusing on migraine, as that is one of the predominant conditions that the general public has. It's also one of, you know, being the general public, chronic migraine, fun. Having migraine be so predominant, it is also something that is very disabling. So we're going to talk about that due to its prevalence. I have listed here the top three oils of each of these types of headache and face pain. This is really based on my experience in working with people, as well as the science behind these individual oils and how they function and how they work within the physiology of our bodies, as well as these conditions. I've also referenced many things based on evidence-based research guides that I use that are extremely helpful, and I will refer to those information books and such at the end of my talk. And I, like many of you, are very focused on the science, but there are sometimes with complementary medicine just an unexplained, not sure why they work, how they work, but there is also the emotional factor for these oils. So there's quite a bit that is wrapped up with essential oils besides science, and it's really quite an experiment to find what works for you. So now it's hard to say, I've listed several oils, it's hard to state one oil works for XYZ face pain or headache type. And that's also due to the significant variance in how each person suffers or experiences their condition or the pain with these types of conditions. Now, on a side note, and a positive aspect, with essential oils, what's nice is that you can customize your oils and how you're using it and your protocol based on what works for you, what types of things you want to address, whether it is the symptoms of these conditions or the triggers, and helping to work with those and eliminate some of that, or at least reduce some of the triggers. Let's see. Now, I've listed for migraine in particular, because again, we're going to focus more about migraine throughout this talk, with basil, peppermint, copaiba, and lavender. I picked these particular ones because of their calming, but also anti-inflammatory effect. They are helpful in relaxing muscles besides the mind and the body. And copaiba in particular is nice because it is a gentle oil, and it's a good starter oil versus peppermint, which can feel kind of icy hot on a lot of people. Let's see here. Now, abdominal migraine, I have it differentiated out between T for topical, and I is the steam for internal use. So these are how you're applying it and my recommendations, whether it's topical, aromatic, or internal. Abdominal migraine can be addressed in both of these ways. So if it's topically, then it's going to work a little bit different, and that's why there's different oils than if you take it internally and trying to address that GI cyclative issue. Tension is something that's usually the easiest one to address, and it's, you know, any of the calming oils will work well, but these are other ones that actually help to relax the muscles. Cluster is a little tricky with medicine as well as in the essential oil world. I did pick frankincense in particular, and that particular type of frankincense, because there are some studies that are showing that it does increase the oxygen level in the brain, which in theory can be beneficial and helpful for those who have cluster. So it is worth a shot. It is something that is difficult to manage in the clinic for physicians, but in the same respect, it's going to be a little more tricky for having oils to support and help in that respect as well. One caveat with the cluster, I listed helichrysum. Helichrysum is something that can increase the anticoagulation meds if you are on them. So that one's one just to be aware of, talk with your doctor about, and start low and slow. So and find out what your tolerance is and how it works with your body. Some people are more sensitive than others in responding to the anticoagulant type feature. And some of the same oils we're talking are listing here for trigeminal neuralgia, neuritis. Neuritis is not necessarily a headache type, but more of a condition. And a lot of people have, I wanted to list it because a lot of people have tenderness over the supraorbital or the occipital region. And these three oils are excellent for anti-inflammatory and bringing down that response in the body. And sometimes just addressing that can help ward off a full-blown migraine or at least reduce that aspect of pain in your migraine and your headache conditions. Sinus headache, I listed that even though it's technically unrelated to what we think of as headache conditions. However, there is belief that the sinus headache is being overdiagnosed and often it's migraine that's being missed. So I wanted to list that because many of you may have been told you have sinus headache and these are the oils that you would use for a true sinus headache. However, if these are not working for you, please feel free to try the migraine oils and see if you have some benefit there. And rebound is, its own animal, but these are some oils that can help in that respect as well. Common migraine symptoms, brain fog, fatigue, muscle tightness, anxiety, nausea, and pain. We're going to talk about these and several of the oils that are supporting you and managing these conditions and these effects. Feel free, by the way, to screenshot the slides or take a picture, and we'll figure out if there's a way to get you the slides later on. But if you want, feel free to do that to have them as reference later. These lists are by no means exhaustive. This is just the top three that I've wanted to list that are helping for the majority of people.
Michele, I don't want to interrupt, but just so that the audience knows, your slides will be available on the website. We'll convert them to a PDF, and they'll be on the special events education page so that they can pull them up and refer to all this awesome information.
Great. Thank you. Thank you. Because it is a lot of information. We're going to try to whip through this here. The symptoms and the side effect, triggers for migraine, like I said, we're going to kind of focus on migraine now, so I hope I don't lose too many of you. But they're easier to address than the actual condition itself. As you know, in medicine, that's even something that's oftentimes elusive. And if we can manage our symptoms and manage our triggers, hopefully that will help with managing the number of times we have migraine. So you'll notice on my slides, previous one and this one and the following one, that there's a lot of the same oils that are listed for different types of either the symptom, side effects, or triggers. And that is because essential oils themselves have hundreds to even 1,000 plus different chemical constituents. Each of the chemical constituents have a different medicinal property. And when you have something that has so many, it's going to work for various things that even can seem unrelated. And they may be unrelated, but due to those chemicals within that plant and that plant's oil, it affects many different things. So don't think of oils in the same respect that we think of medicine, because it is not singular in purpose. And that is what modern medicine is designed for. It's very singular in purpose. It's for controlled purposes. The doctor knows exactly how much you're getting and what impact it should have. So essential oils have more of a balancing effect, and they support the body's natural functions. So that's how essential oils work, not necessarily like we think of in medicine. So once you change your mindset, and you'll find better success because it's not going to be a disappointment, so to speak, because we're addressing it totally differently. And if you want to think of it in this way, if you eat very healthy, then you're reducing some of the problems that you can have with health conditions. So we're just going to try to help the body do what it naturally does and do better. Now, these oils, I've listed a number of resources. I haven't been able to, haven't updated my information when I was doing research with headache, and I pretty much have limited my references to 2014 and earlier. My husband says I need to write a book in regards to all the information that is now out there, and it's quite interesting if you ever want to run into the PubMed world and just do a search on a particular oil and the headache condition and see what's out there and read it for yourself. Under anxiety, I kind of want to touch on this one, anxiety. We have lavender and we also have cedarwood. All of these are very calming oils, these four oils, but in different ways. So lavender kind of has that sedative property, calming to the body, whereas cedarwood is more so the mind, calming the mind, racing at night. So feel free to combine these oils, the list that I have. They oftentimes work better together because you have different properties that you're bringing together. So in that particular respect, if you are using lavender and cedarwood, and we're talking about for sleep, then combining them is excellent for anxiety, but also when we're talking about with sleep. And we're going to touch on that now. So some of the triggers, sleep deprived. We all know how that works. Seasonal allergies, sinus issues, sleep issues, gut health, stress, hormones, and strong odors. I know strong odors is a very common concern that is brought up to me in the migraine world as to whether oils are going to trigger the migraines. And so we'll talk about that as well. Sleep issues in regards to staying asleep, that's the key for using the cedarwood with lavender. And lavender is going to help you fall asleep, cedarwood is going to help you stay asleep and calm the mind. So those are excellent things. Those two I would recommend diffusing. You can use it topically, I do personally. But if you are one that's prone to wake up in the middle of the night, then that's a good thing to diffuse and keep that going with the oils so that you're constantly exposed. Many diffusers, by the way, have an intermittent mode. That is an excellent feature to use because then you are not getting overloaded with a very strong scent, and you can do just a few drops over an 8-hour period of time. Again, when I was talking about essential oils being balancing, this also goes for the hormones notation that I have for male and female. These oils do not give you hormones. They do not replace hormones. They support the body in balancing hormones. So again, having the right mindset and what oils do and what they don't do, okay? Now addressing the strong odors. Like I said, this is a big concern, and I work with a lot of people who have migraine, and I ask generally, as many as I can, in regards to, do they have that trigger? Many do, not everyone, but I have asked them to follow up with me with whether essential oils have become a trigger for them. And then I ask them the brand they're using, how much they're using, etc. Those are factors. But I have found if you are using pure essential oil that's a high quality, then the incidence of it being a trigger is greatly reduced than if you were exposed to, you know, the cleaning products at work or the fragrances in the bathroom, the public restroom, or someone's perfume when you're stuck in the elevator with them. I do know people who have used a diffuser necklace or bracelet and or put a drop on a tissue. They pull it out when they're stuck with somebody in, you know, a short term with some strong perfume that you know is highly going, you know, highly likely to trigger your migraine, and just kind of smell that or smell your bracelet or your necklace. And it has worked really well for most people. I also remember two people at Mayo when we worked there. One was in the GI department and one was a respiratory therapist. Both worked with very foul smelling environments. And those two particular people used peppermint in particular on their mask, and they were able to not smell those foul odors at all. And also helps with the gag reflex and wanting to throw up when you smell those oils. Peppermint can actually help with that. So lots of different ways to use it. And now we're using masks pretty much in our entire daily use outside of our home. That's an excellent time to put just a small drop. You may not even want to do a full drop because peppermint is very strong. It smells great, but it's very strong. And just adjust it to what works for you to help with those strong odors or going out in public and things that you want to avoid. Let's see. I'm trying to catch up on my notes here. Now, bear with me in the rest of the slides. They're not specific to migraine. However, they're very important in helping with oils being helpful and beneficial and having success with them. So I did title this slide, Factors in Oil Ineffectiveness. And the concerns are outweigh what I would say with quality oils. So warning signs are very important. Do know these and look for these when you're purchasing essential oil. I can pretty much assure you anything that you buy at the grocery store, your health food store, Amazon, they're not going to be high quality oils, and don't waste your money. So some of the warning signs: if it has on the label flammable and you're looking at a bottle of lavender, that's a problem. There is something in that oil that is not essential oil that would cause it to be flammable. That is not an item that is typically flammable. There's very few oils that have a low flash point, and I've listed those for you. So that is a big, big concern, what's in there that's flammable. Two, if it's listed for aromatic only, type products, the FDA does not require it to have on their label all the ingredients. They are not required to list it whatsoever. It's up to them if they choose to list anything, so they are not going to be forthright when it's aromatic only, and just assume it is synthetic and full of chemicals. Okay, avoid those at all costs. Also, another red flag is do not ingest. And say it's lavender, it's peppermint. Those are plants that we do eat. Those are edible plants. So there's a reason there's a labeling notation, do not ingest. It is not a high enough quality to be safe to ingest. Also, another flag is expiration date. Oils, pure high-grade essential oils, if they are not open, the bottle's not open, will last pretty much indefinitely. If there's an expiration date, it's likely a carrier oil that is in there that goes rancid. And then it's not going to be very good because it's very diluted and also can be harmful once that oil has gone rancid. Now, another thing that can impact the effectiveness of your oils is using the incorrect quantity, so the incorrect amount. Working with an aromatherapist is very important to get an idea or reference guides and I'll list at the end good places to get some information from. But what's too little and what's too much, and the frequency of application. Just a quick general rule, if you're using it topically, try not to apply more than once every 4 hours, because you can flood your receptors and it will literally feel like it's completely ineffective. And then you'll have to wait a day or so for your receptors to clear. So don't overdo it. Okay. And there is a saying, like, you only need a little if it's a high quality product. Now, incorrect application, choosing the method that is appropriate for your knee. If you stub your toe, diffusing something that has pain relieving properties or anti-inflammatory properties is not going to help you. Your toe hurts. So in general, you're going to apply essential oils to where you feel the pain. Where are you experiencing the pain? And then when storing your oils, avoid direct sunlight and heat. Those break down some of the chemical constituents and make them less effective. Shelf life, again, if it's unopened, should be indefinite. Once it's opened, you're gonna wanna use it within a couple of years, because every time you open the bottle, you're exposing it to air and you're going to start reducing its strength. And citrus is one thing to be aware of. Use it within 6 months to a year, because it does oxidize with being exposed to air. Oxidized essential oils will be a little more irritating on the skin. So that's just something that's a caution. The different applications methods would be internal, which we've talked about, aromatic and topical. We're going to talk about aromatic first. That is the simplest, easiest way to start working with essential oils. As a general guideline, start with diffusing for 15 to 30 minutes only. If it's a diffuser, necklace, or bracelet, try only one drop. If it's a cool mist diffuser, you can do 2 to 3, work your way up. Only do, like I said, 15 to 30 minutes, but 1 to 3 times a day. Don't overdo it. Also start with just a single oil, one single plant oil, so that you know if it's a trigger or not. Use a blend. It's going to have lots of different oils. It's going to be hard to identify. What's nice with aromatically is that it does have effects on you physiologically, your limbic system, as well as psychologically, affecting your emotions, your mood, it's a calming effect. So it's a fun way to start experimenting with essential oils. Topically, the location that I've listed here is really related to headache disorders and facial pain. Obviously, there's a myriad of things that we can talk about, and they have very different locations. Reflexology points are an excellent way to try it as well. So find something that will help you be a little more versed in those points, as well as acupressure points, and try those. But pretty much for migraine type and headache disorders, back of the neck, temples, a little bit under the nose, again, a little bit, we're not talking many drops here. Do a drop, do a touch, and we're gonna talk about diluting in regards to putting it on your skin, okay? I put around the navel because that does apply for the nausea and vomiting and the cyclative nature of the abdominal migraine, but also that nausea that you get from migraines and such. Bath is a good one. Do watch the oils that you use in your bath. And massage is another great way to apply oils topically, and it'll be highly diluted, which is nice to do in a safe way. Cautions with being topical: dilute properly. This is based on the specific oil, which should be listed on the label of your oil. If not, use the reference guides for guidance, or speak to an aromatherapist, as well as age. Age is also another important factor in regards to how much you use. Little ones, obviously, you're going to use far, far less than an adult due to the body mass size. Hot oils is a term that you're going to frequently hear, and those are very irritating to the skin. Everyone knows peppermint is the icy hot feeling, so that's one of the aspects, but cinnamon and oregano actually can give you a chemical burn if you don't have it diluted. So that is why it's very, very important to watch what you're doing. Because I don't want you to come back and say, oh, I tried this and it hurt me. So we have to go over these things, even though it's not specific to migraine, but you have to be able to use them properly and safely. Some oils, typically citrus, can increase your sensitivity to getting a sunburn, as well as shorten the time in which you get a sunburn. So be aware of those. And saying avoiding the eye area. Many of us have eye pain, like a stake in our eye, behind the eye from our migraines. This is one area you're not gonna address the pain in that area with oils. Around, you know, on your cheekbone and above your eyebrow are safer areas. Make sure you dilute and watch sweating, anything that might bring it down into your eye, okay? Some of them, like peppermint, tea tree, those things are highly aromatic and can actually feel as though it's like burning your eyes just from the fumes. So avoid the eye area, stay farther away, and as you use it, you'll become more comfortable. I put avoiding while pregnant and lactating. This is not a hard, fast rule. However, that is an extensive topic that I cannot get into, so I'm going to use generalities, as in just don't do it if you're pregnant or lactating. Consult an aromatherapist, consult some reference guides and your physician before using essential oils with that. And also, if you have an allergy to the plant, avoid the plant. If you're allergic to just the pollen, you typically are going to be fine, because the extraction process of essential oil should not be getting pollen in it. So that's typically not a problem. The lower grade ones, that is more of a possibility, but high quality, you shouldn't have pollen in your oil. So unless it's a true plant allergy, you should be fine. Again, like the other doctor said, spoken earlier, anyone can have an allergy to anything in particular. And just because you didn't have an allergy before does not mean later in life you may not develop one. So just be aware of the oils you use and watch for any kind of reactions. Internal use. There's a lot of aromatherapists that are very adamant about not using it internally. And I would generally say don't, other than unless you're using a high quality and you know it's a pure oil. Just because the label says 100% does not mean it's 100%. There's too many flaws in our labeling system that the FDA allows and to go into that. So if it's a high quality, truly pure essential oil, then yes, I do personally use it internally, and I have also recommended that for others, but that is for advanced users, and I would highly recommend you have advice and guidance in this area. The cautions with that is the quality of your oil. You don't want to be using unsafe products. Also, only ingest products that are from edible plants. Dilute them as well, even though you're taking internally. And you can use capsules. There's even vegetarian and vegan type capsules for those who want to avoid animal products. So that is the easiest way to do vegan internally, is just put a drop in a capsule and some carrot oil. Now, in summary, biological preference. Everyone has biological preference to everything, whether it's over the counter or prescription drugs and including essential oils. One oil is not going to work for everyone. There are generalities. The best example I can give you is with over the counter NSAIDs. You've got Tylenol, Aleve, I know Tylenol is but anyway, Tylenol, Aleve, ibuprofen, aspirin, those are all kind of in the same category and class. Everyone's going to have a preference. everyone's going to say, well, this one works better for me. I prefer this. I prefer Advil, Aleve, et cetera. The reason is biopreference. So you need to find what works for your body, and that goes with essential oils as well. So you're going to, if say you're one of the smaller portion of the population where lavender is not making you feel calm and kind of sleepy, then switch to another oil that has that same class of constituents that has that sedative type property and calming properties, and try those. So don't just try one oil and say it didn't work, therefore all essential oils don't work. That's not the case. You wouldn't say that with aspirin. If you took aspirin once and it didn't work, and not try the others in that class, okay? Also keep in mind, if you are a complex or a chronic case, you're likely going to need to experiment more, okay, than other people, and find the one that works for you, or the blend of oils that works for you. Blends do tend to work better than a single plant oil, but start with singles. We talked about that. The reason is you have far more constituents, chemical constituents that are involved, and many different properties, and it's easier to find your body to find the one that's going to work for you out of that blend. You can use it before an attack, first thing in the morning. You've also heard the term sooner the better. I'll try to speed this up because I'm running long. Consistency is key. Again, don't try it once and then say, hey, they don't work, and they all don't work, okay? Start low and slow, talked about that. Do check for contraindications with current medications and your medical conditions. Some do have warnings in regards to seizures, those who are prone to that, and like we talked about with anticoagulant therapies. Always notify your doctors of all supplements, including essential oils, that you are taking. They may not know what to do with that information, but you need to disclose it. A lot of doctors do know and do have some opinions on what they do or don't want you to take. Okay? Online resources, just to be very simple and quick, Dr. Josh Axe is actually an excellent online resource for the basics of essential oils. You can look at individual oils and kind of get the parameters of what an oil can do and how to use them. He does reference a lot of studies, which is great. And he has lots of do-it-yourself recipes that are pretty reliable. So he is an excellent resource. And I'm going to leave it there in regards to online information for those type of things. PubMed, you want to research your studies. And if you want to look up the list that the FDA does have on essential oils as to what is the GRAS list, the GRAS, that is the generally recognized as safe list, it actually is one specifically to essential oils. So you can see what is basically an edible oil and what is not. Then these are the four reference guides that I have listed that I think are excellent, easy reading, and actually have some information regarding migraines and some of the other headache disorders, at least in the top three of those lists. Those are very helpful, handy reference guides to get, and some are fairly inexpensive. Be an avid ingredient label reader. This is my extra recommendations. Eliminating toxins in your life. One thing that I also teach about besides essential oil safety and uses, this helps reduce the chemical burden on your body, helps your body function more easily by itself or on its own. And just some other things to think about in regards to toxins and chemicals and what we put on our body, and just starting to be really aware of what it is. And if I could, one suggestion as to if you picked an area to try to address in reducing the toxic type chemicals, would be your household cleaners. That's going to be your easiest and simplest one to start out with. And don't overdo it. Don't overwhelm yourself. Take one particular thing and try it and make it. It's easy. The do-it-yourself recipes nowadays are excellent. They're easy. They're inexpensive. You control the ingredients and you know what's your triggers, so you can avoid those and make it very easy for your body to function and not have to try to constantly expel all these extra superfluous chemicals. Avoid Pinterest. So I can just make that note. There's a lot of unsafe recipes and unreliable recipes on there. So just avoid that. Start out with Dr. Axe and his website. I also have a Facebook blog that I call Health Hacks. So it's not just essential oils, it's lots of other things and recipes. And we're going to, actually I'm gonna list this here for you, where you can pull that up and request to be part of our group. I'm going to get far more involved. I've been kind of fairly absent on my social media for the last year due to the babies, but my husband has volunteered to help me. So we're going to try to be much more ambitious in our listing of the recipes, because I will vet every recipe that I put on there and will not just copy and paste anything for you. I absolutely want to make sure it's the best one that I can find for you. So contact me anytime through the above methods, and it'll be great to chat with you and hear your success stories. And if you have any other questions outside of this group.
Great. Was that, I'm sorry, were you done, Michele?
Yes.
Oh, sorry. I didn't want to interrupt you. That was a really great presentation. I don't know that much about essential oils, and that was really fascinating. Do you have time for a couple questions? I know we're running late. Yeah? Okay, yeah. Let's do a couple quick questions. One of them, I think, I'm sort of getting a theme of, you know, where do I buy it? What brand? You mentioned a diffuser that you can do overnight that doesn't, you know, blast you. So I don't know if you want to recommend any specific brands or products, but do you have any kind of places to start for people?
I do personally have preferences based on research and having used and tried many different brands. However, in this type of meeting environment, I'm hesitant to list any particular brand. I just want it to be information specific. But like I had referenced Dr. Axe at the end, he's a great resource for information. But and he does sell some his own brand of essential oils as well. So that's something that's a starting point. But if anyone wants to contact me personally, then I can discuss that. But I'm trying to leave it brand specific.
Yeah. I put your email in the chat section so people could click it. You had a slide, I think, of sort of like what to make sure is not in your product. And so the slides, I believe, will be on Miles from Migraine. So I think that slide would be really helpful for people when they're shopping. Let's see. Another question. What about the dangers to pets or maybe children? Is there anything like that?
Yes, and I'll try to keep it more of a short answer. I use it on our pets and our babies, etc. And the short answer really is it is entirely dependent on the quality of the essential oil that you're using. And whether it's harmful, as well as the quantity and how you're applying. So that is another talk that I do as well. That's a couple hours long. For just pets or for children. But the short answer is yes, you can, but just educate yourself or talk to an aromatherapist, research with reliable sites as to how much is too much. And I cannot emphasize enough like high quality essential oil and researching the companies and how they obtain their oil and where they get it from. So,
yeah.
And there is something to be said with what you pay for is what you get. So, yes.
I heard once that you shouldn't put essential oils directly on your skin, that you should put them in a carrier oil. I don't know if that's correct or not. And secondly, are you always going to kind of be safer with diluting it?
Yes. And as a general rule, a 5% or even a 10% dilution ratio, so 5 or 10% essential oil, the rest being carrier oil, is going to meet most people's needs. Something that is what we're talking about with migraine, trigeminal neuralgia, all these types of things, those more often I personally and recommend use and recommend a much higher concentration, but I'm still diluting. So even if I did a 1-4, so like a 25% essential oil and 75% carry oil, that's a nice strong strength, but we're talking about short-term use, not every day, all day type thing. So yes, you always want to dilute before you put on your skin. The only one that I recommend, that I would say is entirely safe, even on infants, because there's studies showing it, it would be lavender that you could use undiluted. It is the mildest essential oil that there is, but essential oils it's a very thin liquid and aromatic, so it's going to start to evaporate essentially. It's not the same type of oil as your carrier oils, where it's a fatty substance. Essential oils don't have that type of fat. So even if you put it on where there's no carrier oil, it's good to put a carrier oil on top of it. One, to just kind of be easy on your skin, gentle on your skin, but two, it'll drive it in so it won't evaporate. So.
Oh, interesting. Okay. Yeah.
There's just so much to it. I'm trying to
think of
the simplest answers.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds like it's in terms of kids and pets and stuff, you should have some professional help before just sort of pouring this stuff on yourself. Yeah.
Yes.
Let's see.
I'm going to make a quick comment in regards to the pets thing too, because they're of course it went viral. You know, essential oils killed my cat, or essential oils killed my dog. Okay. And I reference people, one, to the quality. Two is that think about all the chemical scents that we have, you know, in our plugins, what are the wallflowers or whatever from Bath and Body Works, you know, our Febreze. Those are constant chemicals that we're putting into the air that we're exposing to our pets and our children, who have much smaller body mass size and require much smaller concentrations of anything in order to be overwhelmed, you know, physically. And also with floor cleaners, people use the Swiffer sweeper, you know, and the wet mop things. That's full of chemicals. Your pets are walking by, they're stepping in it, they're licking off because they clean their paws, they clean their fur, they're on the couch that you sprayed Febreze, and now they're cleaning themselves. They're ingesting all these chemicals. So they've already had all this chemical burden on their body. And if you use a poor quality essential oil or too strong, then that could have just been the straw that broke the camel's back, you know, in the same. And that was just one more thing that just completely overloaded that poor animal. So there's a lot of factors to harming pets and infants and children, but those are kind of the key things to keep in mind. So that's why I also say, you know, non-toxic household products start there. It benefits everybody, including your pets and your children.
Right, right. Yeah. As a migraine patient, we know, like just walking through those, like, I think Bed Bath & Beyond has this candle section now. It just kills me. Ugh.
Or the fragrance center of like the like Nordstrom's.
Oh yeah. And it's always right by the front door, right?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Let's do one final question, because I think this is really interesting. This person said, if the essential oils are used to help the body balance, is it working more of a, as a preventative for migraine than an abortive? If so, how long would you try working with an oil before knowing if it is helping in some way?
Okay. Not necessarily. I'm hesitant to use the word abortive. However, I do know a number of people who, as soon as they start to feel a migraine, so again, starting early on, who have used essential oils, who have been able to prevent it from going full blown. So it is a possibility. It is harder with those who are chronic, because you typically every day have that migraine. So you're already there at that baseline having a migraine. If you're episodic, it's easier to manage it and maybe divert it, you know, early on. So, and then I also know people, and I've experienced it as well, haven't done it much lately, but using a diffuser necklace. So it's a little pad with a felt a little felt pad that you can put a drop of essential oil on. You're getting it just a light aromatic essence of it all day long. People have used it that way to kind of keep their headaches at bay and from coming back, and they've seen a reduction and not coming up. But again, these are people who are episodic, not chronic, and at least in the experiences that I have and with working with people. So in a way prophylactically, in a way abortively, but it's really just the biggest factor is going to be attacking the triggers first and managing your symptoms. And if you're lucky, then awesome. You know, you might respond to being able to cut that migraine down if you attack it in the beginning.
And how long would you try like a certain oil before knowing it's helping you or not?
I would give it probably at least 3 tries, you know, because you're going to know. It's going to affect. What's nice is with essential oils, they do have an effect on the body very rapidly, far more so than your tablet abortive, where you have to wait for it to dissolve, get through the GI system, and then work. It's literally within seconds to minutes that you're going to know if you're starting to feel better. And that is, yeah, that part is wonderful. And it's kind of like the nasal sprays, how they work far faster. And aromatically, you can, it's all along that line of how it's working.
Okay, great. Yeah. So I think, you know, you were kind enough to give your email address. So if people have more questions, they can email you there. Sure. Going way over time here, so I think we're going to end. Thanks. That was a really great presentation. I enjoyed that.
Thank you.
Okay, everyone, we have to end now, but what a great event today. Thank you to Dr. Zanzari Hutchinson and Buse and Michele Vargas for these amazing presentations. Please remember to sign up for our next virtual education day next Saturday when we are having a migraine and telemedicine special event with Dr. Anika Salim and Dr. Andrew Blumenfield. Don't forget that you can also sign up for any of our virtual run, walk, just relax events. Cleveland, Boston, and Portland are coming up in July. And you can do a virtual run, walk event just anytime, anywhere as well. Thanks again to Amgen, Novartis, Lilly, Teva, Allergan, and Lundbeck for supporting our event today. Have a great rest of your weekend, and thank you for supporting Miles for Migraine and joining us today. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Ansari.
Sure. Bye.